Everybody's here. Good job. Like, a lot of people were saying Friday's work. Awesome. So we're still prepping for next week's lab, trying to talk about benzene and acetonide trial. Today we'll look at all the vibrational modes of acetonide trial and of benzene. So you'll get to see a lot of shaking shakes. A lot of good dance moves you picked up today. Also, go ahead and read Monday's lab so you can prepare for next week. But substantial changes are coming on Sunday. That's the only day I have the time to make modifications to it. In the past, we had an older Raman spectrometer, and I wanted to teach y'all how to calibrate the diode array. So there was a whole portion of the lab where you used acetonide trial in both the IR and the Raman to calibrate the Raman spectrometer. We're going to cut that section out of the lab. So that's good news for you. That's less work. Okay. But the bad news is there's substantial changes in the lab, and I'm not going to get those done until Sunday. Okay. So Sunday night there'll be a new chapter uploaded in the Raman IR folder. Okay. And it's going to have information about our new Raman spectrometer that we got as a result of the flood of January. And we have a new infrared spectrometer as a result of the flood. So we have two brand new pieces of equipment in the lab. The nice thing about the Raman is the last one had a 785 nanometer laser. So all throughout the lab that you're going to be reading, it's going to talk about the 785 nanometer laser and how it's in the just slightly in the infrared region. And so the detector wasn't able to detect the shifted photons for the CH stretch region. Well, our new laser is a 532 nanometer laser. It's a green laser. And our visible detector can now detect the CH stretch region. So this is good news. Our Raman trace, which has the Raman spectrum of acetonitrile and benzene, will go all the way out past the CH stretch, and so will our IR spectrum. And so we're gonna get full data for all of the vibrational modes for both molecules. And then we'll also, I may add this actually to the lab where you will at least show the spectrum of chlorobenzene and compare it to benzene. Because we see benzene is D6H, very symmetric molecule. We'll see today that there are a whole lot of infrared bands that are not allowed in the IR or the Raman because of the symmetry of the molecule. Take a hydrogen off and put a chlorine on, you have the same number of atoms, same number of 3N minus 6 vibrational modes, but now all of a sudden you've broken the symmetry. It's C2V. And because it's C2V, a whole lot more peaks are allowed, and they show up in the spectrum. So we take a molecule that's supersymmetric, like benzene, and then we break the symmetry with a chlorine atom. And we see all of a sudden the spectrum gets really complicated. And so that's a very clear illustration of how symmetry can explain the differences between chlorobenzene and benzene. Benzene spectrum is way too simple for the big molecule that it is. And it tells you that that molecule is really symmetric. Whereas if you had some other structure for six carbon atoms and six hydrogen atoms that wasn't symmetric, you'd have a really complicated spectrum. So that's getting ready for next week. So we finished this last time. We were looking at Rayleigh scattering, and the two types of Raman scattering, Stokes shift, where the see this arrow is shorter? So that means this is a longer wavelength. The up means this is the laser, the incoming photons, and the down arrow means that's the outgoing photons. So we detect the shorter arrow, which means the longer wavelength arrow. So we're detecting red-shifted light from our laser. Over here, if we have excited molecules, like in a flame, then we can hit it with our laser and we might get some blue shifted photons. This is a longer arrow, which means a shorter wavelength. The nice thing about doing the anti-Stokes Raman is that it gets us away from the fluorescence region. Fluorescence is always red shifted from the incident light. And so we could be over on the blue side of that laser and we shouldn't see any in the background. We shouldn't see any light other than anti-Stokes Raman. But we're not going to be able to do this. So Stokes Raman is the Raman that we're doing for the lab. So this is the infrared spectrum that we're going to get in a couple of weeks when we do the carbon monoxide lab. And I just wanted to point out a few things. You know, here's CO2, and then there's a Raman active mode for CO2. And notice the numbering. you know, we now have four vibrational modes in CO2, but one of them is doubly degenerate. So we only see three peaks. We see this bending motion. Now, just traditionally, it was labeled new two, so the second vibrational motion. And so its quantum number is here in the middle of this sort of bracket of three quantum numbers. And so this would be new one, new two, and new three. And so this right here is an E mode, so it counts twice. So there's one, two vibrational modes here, three for the Raman, and four for this one, this asymmetric stretch. So now instead of like the particle in the box having one quantum number, we have a quantum number for all 3n-6 or 3n-5 vibrations. And so in the x-axis, the transition equation, the Hamiltonian would operate on a vibrational wave function for every one of those. So it gets really big. Okay. And so this would be the energies for the vibrational motions for the molecule. This would be the energies for the excited states. You take the difference and you get your transition equation. And then the y-axis, of course, would be the transition dipole moments for those. Now, we're dealing with fundamentals. So even though we learned about hot bands and we learned about overtones, we're not going to see any of those. Everybody clear on that? Every peak you see in this spectrum, with the exception of these two, okay, is a fundamental. These two are combination bands. And we'll learn at the end of class today what a combination band is.
But that's the key branch,
right? We haven't gotten to that yet. Yeah, well, we will. And so also, since these are fundamentals, all of these lower vibrational states have the quantum number 0, 0, and 0. So when we're labeling these, all we have to do is label them with the destination. We're labeling them with where they went. So we're labeling this one 0, 1, 0. They started at 0, 0, 0 and went to 0, 1, 0. We're labeling this one with its destination 1, 0, 0. And we're labeling that one with its destination 0, 0, 1.
Will there be a situation where there's more than one non-zero number in that set?
Yes, and so the combination bands would be an excitation of two quantum numbers or three at the same time. And so the molecule is, you've got the, say, the symmetric stretch like this and the bend. And that one over there, one of those is two quanta in the bend and the symmetric stretch. So it's going from a normal vibration to a faster vibration. And it's doing this, I guess. So they're stretching and bending at the same time. So here's just the single vibrational modes. These are the stretches. This is the asymmetric stretch, and this is the symmetric stretch. Without looking at anything else on this chart, can you look up here and see, this is the intuition I want you to gather, which one of those is infrared active? Very good. Why did you say that? What was obvious to you?
Light will bounce off.
What is it about light that's interacting with the molecule? What is light? What is the generic term for light? Electromagnetic radiation. The magnetic field is so small, we really don't worry about it. So it's the electric field. What is an electric field? Plus or minus charges. And so you need to have something that oscillates the plus and minus charges in a molecule for it to absorb light. And so up there at the top, you see the carbon atom is going back and forth. It's more positive than the oxygens. And so as it's oscillating back and forth, there is an electric field in that molecule that's oscillating, and that's what light can interact with. This one right here, the positives and negatives are getting farther apart, but it's still symmetric no matter where it is. And so there's no electric dipole change in this molecule here when it vibrates. So this one is not infrared active. But it is Raman active. Raman is interacting with the oscillation in the electron cloud, and it's very symmetric. If you look at basically the size of the electron cloud, if the size changes of the electron cloud, then it's highly Raman active. And you see how this one, the whole molecule shrinks, and the whole molecule expands. So this one would be very Raman active. You'd see a large Raman peak for it. But up there, you see the molecule size doesn't change. The oxygen-oxygen distance is about the same in the top one. And so it's not Raman active. We see that here too. If you look at this one, you see if I were to draw arrows, I would draw an out arrow here and an out arrow there. And so it's the same in the Z direction. Remember, the axis of the molecule is the Z axis. And so the positive Z looks the same as negative Z, meaning they're both arrows that go out away from the origin. And so that would be Z squared. Z squared in this character table, Z infinity H is A1G. And then up there, if I were to draw arrows, both the oxygens, if I took a snapshot, the arrows would be pointing in one direction. So just like the Z-axis, the arrows are pointing along the Z-axis. It would be Z. So that'd be A1U, the top one, and would be IR active.
How do you spell on the letter? Just, you know, Z squared is always...
You know that the axis of a symmetric molecule like this, the rotation axis, is the Z axis. And so we'll get some more practice with the vibrational arrows.
Yes. So you said we're talking about whether or not the stretches were IR active. Does the fact that that is the asymmetric stretch versus the symmetric stretch matter, or is it simply that the stretch is asymmetric in some way for it to be? Like, when we were talking about the symmetric stretch of water, it wasn't, I mean, the hydrogens and oxygen were moving symmetrically, but the motion wasn't really
symmetric. Yeah, here it is. Here's the symmetric stretch in water.
Yeah. So, all that motion doesn't cancel out. So, is that stretch IR active?
Yes.
Okay.
In fact, all of these in water are IR active. Yeah. So it's not the fact that it's symmetric versus asymmetric, it's does it set up a change in the electric dipole that makes it IR active. Here's the other thing too that's really simple in the character table. If it's a single X, a single Y, or a single Z, or even an X comma Y, it's IR active. Everybody catch that? It's real simple. You're looking at the character table, you see a single X, a single Y, or a single Z, that's IR active. Yeah, absolutely. Clear from the character table. In fact, that's why sometimes the character table will have at the top IR, and it'll have all of the single X, the single Y, and the single Z. Or, like I said, even if it's X comma Y in parentheses, that's still a single X comma single Y in parentheses. Those are IR active. And if you see any two combination, like X squared, Y squared, Z squared, or XY, XZ, YZ, all six of those are Raman active. So the character table really helps us with the selection rules. When I say IR active, I mean the selection rules allow an IR transition for X, Y, or Z. If I say that it's Raman active, I'm saying that the symmetry selection rules allow that transition to occur in the Raman. And if you think about it, it makes sense, because the Raman is a two-photon technique here. So you could have a Z-polarized photon come in and a Z-polarized photon come out. That's Z squared. And that interaction is Raman active. That's the two photons coming in that are polarized in the Z direction. Yes?
What about like Z squared minus Y squared or something like that?
It's still got a squared or still any kind of X squared plus Y squared or X squared minus Y squared, those are Raman active, those motions. Okay. Now we're talking about the vibrational motions. Yes.
So in here, we can look at the molecules move and stretch, and we can tell if it's IR or Raman.
Mm-hmm.
Is there like a practical way of doing it, like on a sheet of paper?
Yeah, so we have, I'll draw the top one. Ooh, that's terrible. So I drew my z-axis first, because that's the axis of the molecule. Then I did the counterclockwise right-hand rule for x and y. And I'm looking at this, and I see that, again, this is the positive part of the z-axis, right? Plus 1, plus 2, etc., going the other way, minus 1, minus 2. And I'm looking at this arrow, right? The z-axis is increasing to the right. This arrow is increasing to the right. That arrow is increasing to the right. This carbon is going the opposite direction to keep the molecule from translating. And so I'm going to set up an oscillating dipole moment that's along the z-axis. So it's different in positive z than it is in negative z. So my little flow chart would say, yeah, it's different in positive and negative z, therefore it has z character. So that would put me on this row here, which would tell me it's A1U, and it has a single z, so it's IR active. Yes?
So determining the IR moment active is only for vibrations, right?
Yes, because in the molecular orbital theory, we have to look at the upper state and the lower state analyte, because we might have the reason this is easy is because the ground state is always top row. So the only thing that's not top row is the upper state that you're going to. So if you have Z polarized light and the upper state is, let's just do that. Upper state is A1U, lower state is A1G. Always for vibrations. We're dealing with fundamentals, right? So we're in a ground state. Ground state's A1G. My vibration here, this piece right here, is there. And so I'm looking at the character table. What could possibly cancel this Z symmetry? Light that has Z symmetry. So A1U. Oh, goodness. A1U is the only thing that's going to cancel or be compatible with this to make this A1G. And so essentially, I need an A1U to make that transition to A1U. So that's why it's so simple in vibrational spectroscopy. The ground state being A1G really helps things. So whatever the motion is, that's the kind of light I need. So let's do, we've done water. We kind of beat that one to death. We have these three vibrational motions. We have the symmetric stretch, we have the asymmetric stretch, and the symmetric bend. Let's go to a more complicated molecule. Okay, let's go to acetonitrile. This is the molecule we're going to do next week in lab, one of them. Yes?
Because water is always moving, it will always have that electric backbone.
Yes. Okay. Yes, and so it never stops. There was some unfortunate confusion on the exam on the question that said we can go to absolute zero Kelvin. I know people played around with the spreadsheet and they thought all the peaks disappear at zero Kelvin. Absorption peaks don't disappear. If you had looked on like some of the sheets back then, especially the ones that contain the Boltzmann factor, putting T equals zero is dividing by zero in the exponent of the Boltzmann factor. And so you got an error and all of the peaks disappeared because there was an error in the spreadsheet. But some people play with 1 Kelvin and they said, oh, the fundamental stays at 1 Kelvin but disappears at 0. It disappeared at 0 only because there was a numerical error. Okay? So at absolute 0, if you could get there, which you can't get there, so next year I'll change it to 1 Kelvin. Okay? So maybe, but I was saying, as you go towards 0, as I should have said that, as you go towards absolute 0, what peaks disappear? The thing I was aiming for was that you understood what the term hot band meant, right? So hot bands disappear. The hot band overtones, like going from 2 to 7 or something like that, those would disappear too because it starts in level 2. But the overtones that start in level 1 would still remain as well. They would just be smaller intensities just because they're always smaller intensities than the fundamental. But the main point was the fundamental would remain and the hot bands would disappear at really cold temperatures. And that's why we cool things down in physics and in chemistry to keep the spectrum simple if we have a really complicated situation. But yeah, there's always motion. Even at, if you could get close to absolute zero, if you have a molecule, it's still stuck in that ground vibrational state, and it's still going to be moving. So these are the vibrational modes for acetonitrile. Okay? Let's calculate how many there should be. So draw acetonitrile in your notes. You know what it is. Okay. CH3CN. So there's our molecule, has a threefold symmetry axis. What's the point group? 3, 2, 1, go. I heard like C, yes. C3 is threefold axis. And V, because it has three vertical
reflection
planes. Thank you for helping. Yeah, C3V.
My words are hard today. I don't know. I'm sleepy.
So here is C3V. There's the coordinate system. There's the molecule. How many atoms? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. N equals 6. 3N equals?
18.
18. Okay, minus 6. Because it's a nonlinear molecule.
12.
Okay, it's 12 vibrations. So how come I only have 8 peaks? Or 8 frequencies? Yes! You're like, duh! The E's here. There's 2 for each of these. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Got them all. Isn't that cool? We're going to see all of them but this one. This one's at 362 wave numbers, and it's below the cutoff of our KBR windows. So infrared, right, molecules absorb. Glass has got a lot of things that can absorb infrared light. So we can't use glass windows in our spectrometer. We have to use salt windows. We use potassium bromide. So these, they look like glass. Don't touch them. You got the salt windows, and they're pure salt, but they cut off at around, what did I say, 560 or so, 550 wave numbers, and so it gets really noisy because there's no light. You're taking, you know, something small signal and dividing by even a smaller signal, and so the absorbance is crazy. And so anyway, we won't see this one, but we will see all of these others, and you'll be able to assign them. So let's look at the spectrum. Here's the spectrum that you're going to have in your lab. So this top one is the infrared signal. Let's see if I can. The bottom one is the Raman signal. It's dotted. Notice how it stops right here. That's because the detector couldn't go any further, but this year it will. Okay, so this year it'll go even further, and we'll get the CH stretch region. So what's going on here? Down here are the different bends in the molecule. Here are the stretches in the molecule. So if you think about a spring, it's harder to stretch a spring than it is to bend a spring. And so the higher frequencies are the stretches. The lower frequencies are the bends. Don't take my word for it. Let's look at the pictures. Okay, so nu 8. Again, there's 2 vibrations there, and one is in the x direction, one is in the y direction. And so here they are. You see, this one is, looking at my coordinate system, kind of rotated. But still, let's say that's y. See, that's the y direction. And you can see that this is the... This yellow vector here is the change in dipole moment. The dipole moment changes along y. And so y polarized light would excite this motion. And x polarized light would excite that one. You just can't see the vector because it's going behind us into the forward. So that's really low frequency. It's the bend of this nitrile group. And that's the spring causing that thing to stay straight is really weak. And since the spring is weak, it's really low frequency, 360 wave numbers. So we don't see it. So it's just doing this. Whoa, and it comes back. You know. So then we come up, we'll just make a tour and go through these. This one is symmetric, A1, A4. And so that's that heavy old methyl group. And you wouldn't think a methyl group's heavy, but it's a lot heavier than a hydrogen. So the whole C3 is going way far from the molecule and coming back. So since a lot of mass is moving, it's a low frequency. And it's a single bond that's stretching, so it's a weak spring. So weak spring and a lot of mass. So you can have a stretching mode that's low frequency if you're moving a lot of mass and it's a single bond. Yes.
So it's safe to say that the... I could do this.
Uh-huh.
The nitro group with the triple bond, the frequency is faster when it bends than if it was to stretch the methyl group of the supernatural.
No, the bending of that cyanide group was way over here at 360. It was a really weak spring.
It was weak.
Yeah, and now we're stretching a bond, but we're moving a lot of mass.
Okay.
Okay, and so if I were to draw the arrows for this, look at the, this arrow would go down, the carbon would go down, the hydrogen would go down, the hydrogen would go down. So this whole methyl is moving down. Now the molecule is going to be translating in that direction unless I counteract it with some up arrows on the cyano group. And so this whole thing is going up, the methyl is going down, I'm just stretching that bond. And it has a very distinct frequency at around, I don't know, 900 wave numbers. The next one is a doubly degenerate motion. And this is the rocking of the methyl group. The first one is the rock of the cyano group on top. Now the methyl is just rocking. So I'm not changing any bonds, I'm just changing bond angles. See, really, that bond, look at that bond angle between carbon, carbon, hydrogen. So that bond angle is changing, but the bond lengths really aren't. And so again, the restoration or the spring constant for that force is really low, and so it's a low frequency. The hydrogens are light, so it's a higher frequency than it would be if those were chlorines or something. But it's that's going to be what we call a methyl rock. So it's rocking. And then this one is moving like this. The other one is moving like that. We're not really changing the bond angle for these three atoms on this one. We're changing the bond angle for the other two. Okay. And up here, we're changing the bond angle for that one quite a bit. Now here's another another bend. This would be what we call the umbrella mode for the methyl. You see how it's an umbrella in the wind? It's like, oh heck, you know, it's inverting. Dang, there it goes. You know. So that I can't do it with my hands. My fingers won't do that. You got the picture right there. And so that one, again, you're changing those bond angles, but now all three bond angles are changing at the same time. They're all shrinking and all expanding. Whereas the other one, some were expanding and the others were shrinking. Okay, so just like you can have arrows that stretch and compress bonds, you can have arrows that make the angles bigger or smaller. This one is the deformation of these bond angles inside the methyl. So now these are the bond angles between the hydrogens on that carbon. The bond angle here is not changing that much. It looks like it is a little bit, but it's not changing as much as the last one. It's mostly the methyl group deformation. So it's deforming itself.
So with the umbrella mode, would those cancel each other out because they're all moving
at the same time? What do you mean cancel each other out? They're all swinging up and swinging down. And it's pretty bright IR mode because the positive charges are moving down and up.
It still has the symmetry.
Yeah, so all of these are infrared active. We're measuring them right here in the infrared. Now look at this one. This strange region here, 2200 to 2400, is a unique region. Only a carbon-nitrogen triple bond absorbs there. So if you see a peak right here, it's going to be a cyano group of some sort in your molecule. Very easily to easy to diagnose. And so you can see that's the stretch of the CN. Now this is a little overdone. It's not to scale, right? I mean, they're like fusing. So we have a fusion reaction going on there. But no, it's just to overemphasize the motion of those two atoms. Now we get into the CH stretches. Here's the symmetric stretch. All three CH bonds are expanding at the same time. And then here's the asymmetric stretch. And so this one is the easiest to see. This hydrogen-carbon bond is stretching a lot while those two compress. And this, if you just take the top of that molecule off, that's the same motion you see in ammonia. Anytime you have three atoms bonded to one atom, you're going to have these kinds of modes. Notice the bond angles are not changing. Bond angle changing is called bending, and this is a stretch. So bends and stretches are completely different. So those are all of the vibrational modes in acetonitrile, and they're also Raman active. Now what's interesting on this chart is I have this stick spectrum showing the Gaussian results, and the little X's are the Raman results, and the pluses are the IR results. So you'll have that data too, because you calculated the Gaussian vibrational frequencies for these two molecules. And so you'll go in and you'll pull the IR intensity and the IR frequency, and you'll scale the frequency by 0.915 or something like that. And look how close it lines up. It's pretty cool. I got those vibrational pictures from Gaussian. You can animate them. And so what you've done is you've just assigned this spectrum. Mm-hmm. You've taken a complex pattern that you get of light interacting with matter, and you've used Gaussian, and now you know what the molecule's doing when it absorbs light right there. That's cool. Okay. And are you able to assign the quantum numbers? Yes. They all started out at V equals zero. And then this one we call nu 7. And so at that peak, it went, all the others are zero. It went from zero to zero in all other modes. But for this one, it went to one. So this is the fundamental for nu 7. So if you were to write out, it would be really ugly, but if you were to write out next to all of these peaks, you would have 0, 0, 0, 0, you know, 12 of them, and a 1 in the one that, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, look at that, I got lucky. Okay, so that's what would be the quantum number transition for one of these, okay? So all the others stayed put, and that molecule absorbed at that peak one jump and one quantum number for one vibration. Now, where did all the other peaks? They've got billions upon billions of molecules in the light beam. And so, you know, 100,000 absorbed this, or it's even more ridiculous. Like 10 to the 13 absorbed at this peak, and a different 10 to the 13 absorbed at that peak. Okay, so every peak is a whole group of molecules that absorbed light there and took it away from our spectrometer. Or in the Raman spectrum, like 10 to the 15 molecules scattered these photons, and a different one set of molecules scattered that photon. And so it's just the probabilities of these different molecules doing different things with light that we get this complex spectrum out of a population of molecules. So try to get away from thinking this is one molecule absorbing all of these and becoming super excited. The chances of that molecule absorbing all of these at the same time is essentially zero. We've got enough molecules here that some of the light's absorbed by these and nu 7, you know, this peak here, and a whole different group of molecules absorbed for nu 2. Yeah.
So if you had a really dilute sample, mm-hmm. and you were trying to use IR, would you simply just run it for a longer time?
Yeah, but it's just there's limits to the sensitivity, because the longer you look, you're also collecting noise. And so just trying to get the signal from the noise is a problem. Yeah, so there's a limit. Infrared, you get down to, like if you're doing it in a solvent, but below 2% or 1%, you're really falling into the background. Yeah, so you just need a brighter source. That's why you... We did some infrared for really dilute molecules in a vacuum, and we used a laser, an infrared laser. So we just had many more photons, and so we, because our light source was brighter, we could detect smaller signals. Yeah. So these are all of the vibrational modes for acetonitrile. Here's benzene, a D6H molecule, super symmetric, and notice now what we see, but before, let's go all the way back to refresh our memory. Here's all of the vibrational frequencies for acetonitrile. They're all Raman and IR active, because this is a C3V molecule. Benzene's D6H. Here's the selection rules of the activity. We've got a couple that are Raman active and then a forbidden. FTIR active, forbidden. Raman, FTIR, Raman, forbidden, FTIR. So there are certain vibrations in the molecule that just won't interact with light. They don't substantially change the electron cloud, they don't create a dipole moment, and so they're transparent. They just don't absorb.
Yes. How do you measure them?
Yeah, you really can't. You just have to, you can't measure them directly with light. Yeah, so you have to measure them to know their existence. You'd have to get to the like the heat capacity, knowing that you could store energy in certain motions in this molecule. It has a higher heat capacity than what you thought, meaning there are levels there that are able to be populated, but you wouldn't be able to measure them directly with light. Now, you might be able to get evidence of their existence from combination bands. We didn't talk about it, but notice there's a couple of these that have two frequencies associated with them. Nu 3 plus nu 4. And so that's a combination band, and some of these have a substantial transition dipole moment integral. Remember, the intensity is related to that integral of the ground state, the excited state, and light. And that excited state might have enough overlap, we call it, in that integral with the ground state to give you a decent intensity. And so some of these show up in the infrared, and here's one of them. Nu 3 plus nu 4, and it has the symmetry of A1. So whatever asymmetry is in these two has canceled out, and it's become fully symmetric. And so let's look at nu 3 and nu 4. Here's nu 4, and nu 3 is here. If you take this frequency and add it to that frequency, you get that frequency. And so it's just being excited in two quantum number. And so if you were to write this out, you'd have a one there and maybe a one there. So it's two quantum jump into two different vibrational modes. And then the frequency at that transition is just the sum of those. And that's an exam question, and it's on the homework. You know, it's like, here's the combination band. What do you think the frequency would be? All right, and we'll see in CO2, it's just however many jumps you have, you add all those frequencies up, and you get the total. And so think about it, this is nu 3 plus nu 4, so that tells you right there, you just add them. So you might be able to get a combination band with one of these forbidden ones. So if you saw a peak, and it was 670 plus, let's do this one, it's forbidden. So you had a peak at 1683, right? You're like, 1683, what the heck is that? I don't see, God, I hope I don't see 1683. So you don't see 1683 anywhere in the list, right? You're like, what could that possibly be? He said, well, hey, it matches nu 6 plus nu 4. And so you might say, oh, now I know what nu 6 is. Yeah, and you can assign it. You can get a more accurate reading. Let's say it wasn't 1683, it was 1653, and so you might be able to adjust this number. Yes.
Okay, so for the ones that say like FTI or NMOM, and you will see them on the spectrum, but the forbidden ones you don't see.
Right, you don't see because they're just not able to absorb. So let's look at those modes. Now this is out of an ancient book, it's 1945, right? So at Hertzberg, Gerhard Hertzberg is a fantastic, I would say. What do you want to say? I mean, he collected spectra of diatomic molecules and polyatomic molecules and published these two or three long books. It just has spectral assignment after spectral assignment. It was before we had the internet, before we had places where you could search online and get these frequencies. And so he did, in these books, a great service to science. But now we have websites that are funded by the NSF and so on. And so here's one. And you can just Google benzene vibrations and get to this. University of Liverpool. And so let's look at the vibrations of benzene.
It's like a really good university for PCM, because every time I Google something with PCM.
Oh, really? Liverpool, yeah, that's good. So here's all of our vibrational modes we saw in that previous table. And so let's just pick one. Oh, good. Got a breathing mode. Does that help? See the little arrows? You can kind of see the heads of the arrows. So this is just breathing out, breathing in. So this is that all the CC bonds are getting longer, but the CH bonds are not. So this is just the ring stretching mode. Okay. Is that going to be IR active? Is there any change to the positive charges on the molecule? Does it break symmetry along the x-axis, the y-axis, or the z-axis? No, so it's not going to be IR active. Does the size of the electron cloud change? Absolutely. It's going to be very strongly Raman active. Okay. It's going to be a big signal, too. Let's pick one. Oh, the A2U mode, that's a great one. Okay. Isn't that cool? Another umbrella mode. This one is huge. So it's kind of a weird umbrella. It's flat. first of all, tell me X, Y, or Z, what's the symmetry of this motion? But I don't have the coordinate system. How am I supposed to know, right?
Z?
Yeah, people are saying Z. Why are you saying Z? Someone who never talked before. Yes.
Up and down motion.
Yeah, the C6 axis is up and down, right? And the C6 axis is the Z axis. And so that motion is up and down along the Z axis. So this is Z polarized light that would excite this motion. Is the dipole changing? Quite a bit, right? All the positive hydrogens are going down to one side of the molecule and creating a dipole. And then sometime later, the dipole completely changes direction. So this will be really strong in the infrared. Oh, this works. That's cool. I can just see this. Look at that. Okay, this one's good. Yeah, so let me try to line it up. All right, so I'm just going to...
It does.
Wait, I've rotated now. The z-axis is coming out. Oh, this pen, I gotta throw it away. What? It doesn't really matter how I label the x and y axes. Can you see that the way I've drawn the coordinate system here? What's the symmetry of that one? So we're saying XY, but is it XY or just X? Oh, wow, a lot of people just said X. Why is it not XY?
Because those vectors are canceling out that are going
up. Yeah, so the ups and downs cancel out. Another way to think about it, it's the same in X. I mean, it's the same in Y. Up and down is the same. Up is the same as down, if I look at those arrows. But left is different than right. And that has priority. That's wherever it breaks symmetry has priority. So the left and right differences take over. And so that's just X, the way I've drawn it here. But if I had rotated my coordinate system, it would be Y. The thing it is not is Z. Okay, and if you looked at the character table, you would see X, Y. So it didn't matter if it was X or Y. It's just important that you realize it's one of those, not X times Y. Okay, let's try to find one that's X times Y. That's cool, it kind of rotates, you see. Yeah. I like this one. This one is X times Y. You tell me why. If I take a snapshot of those arrows, I'm just gonna delete the Z-axis to keep things clean, okay? So I have an arrow that's going out here and there. And I have an arrow that's coming in here and here. I see that pattern of plus, minus, plus, minus. I see this pattern where it swaps every time I go around the quadrants. I go quadrant to quadrant and it swaps. It's a little more difficult to see, I grant that. But when you see that pattern, like this. You see all four quadrants across the way, they're the same, but going around, they switch every time I go past an axis. Somebody see that? That's the X times Y. And so I would look in the character table and find X times Y. X, Y really close together. No commas, no parentheses. Okay? Not between the X and Y. So X times Y, that's going to be this motion. Let's try to find one that's x squared minus y squared. Oh. Yeah, that's it. The coordinate system's slightly off on this one, that's why it's not so clear. But if I look at that molecule here, what do I see? I see arrows that go up here like that, and an arrow that comes in here. So when I have nodes that go like this, I see plus patterns here, plus patterns here, minus patterns there, minus patterns there. So these are always coupled together in symmetric molecules where the nodes are 45 degrees from each other. So these have the same frequency. If you'll notice, this is 3352. What was the other one? 33, no. Where did I lose it? Yeah, that's the one. I don't know how I missed it. Look at the mouse. Yeah, okay, it was just, yeah. So that's the one that I called x squared minus, that's the one I called xy. And this is the x squared minus y squared. If you look at the D6H character table, those two are coupled. Okay. And if you look at the nodes, look how the arrows swap. Going from here to there, there's nodes here. And look at this one, the arrows going out, change direction when I go past this node, to change direction back when I go to that node. And so both of these are going to be degenerate in energy. They're going to be a degenerate set. It's a lot harder, I think, to see these with the arrows than it is with the molecular orbitals. When I have the shading, it's easier to see these, because the colors change. But the arrows and the colors, if you could take arrows that go out and think of them as one color, and arrows that go in and think of them as another color, then you see this pattern of color changes here and color changes there. Now, how do I justify that it's x squared minus y squared? Look at this. If I'm looking over here and I'm going out, these arrows are going out, and I just say, okay, that's positive. Well, here, these arrows are going out here. That's also positive. Those bonds are getting bigger. Okay? And so if I'm on the negative x, but I'm getting a positive result, that's x squared. See that? And here I'm going up here in positive y, but it's a negative. The bonds are getting shorter. And I go to negative y, and the bonds are getting shorter. It's y squared, but negative y squared. Right? No matter where I am on the y-axis, the bonds are getting shorter. And so that's minus y squared. So x squared minus y squared would be this motion. At some time later, they'll flip signs. But, those are all the vibrational motions. Oh, darn. I had a Kahoot where you would look at the arrows and pick the symmetries. So we'll start that on Monday morning and see.